Okay, so my recording has started, and now you can take over, Priscilla, and read through the slides. Click the Can you make it a slideshow, Priscilla? Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you, Priscilla, so much. You can stop presenting the screen and I will take over. Let me first unpresent. My computer is a little slow today. I do not know why. Okay, can everyone see my screen? Can you confirm whether you're able to see my screen? Okay, great. Thank you so much, Niyati and Joel. So let's can't even see my cursor. It's looking very different, the cursor itself. So far, as we said, we started about parallel computing, right? So we are constantly talking about parallelism. Then we went into a processor, and one of the ways of parallel computing was using a multi-core processor. And in this, we came across different type of processor types, SIMD, single instruction, multiple data, where you give one instruction to the processor and all the cores in the processor will. Hold on, computer is very slow, I don't know why. So where we give one instruction to the processor, all the cores will get that instruction, and but each core in the processor will get a different data set to operate on. So it's the same instruction, but multiple data, so you don't have to send the instruction differently for each core in the processor. It becomes very faster, so thus the processor is tuned for operating on different data sets. And the other types was SISD, which is the earlier day processor, where you can send only one instruction to the processor. There is no multi-core in that. It is a single core and it can operate on single data at a time. It cannot even operate on multiple data. This was an earlier day sequential computers. And then we have multiple instruction, multiple data, means you can send different instructions to different cores with different data sets. And then you have MISD. So MISD, where you have different instructions, but the same data. So yesterday when we mentioned about how parallel computing is achieved, one technique was functional decomposition, right? In functional decomposition, we have different types of tasks, but it operates on the same data. So for example, if I want to calculate the sine value, or this is involving mathematics now when I'm talking about sine, so I hope people are knowing mathematics. So definitely if I have a value of x, and if I want to calculate, let's say the sine of that, the cos of that, the tan of that, in such cases the instructions are the computation instructions are different, but the data is the same. And in this case, you may have SIMD, you may have X, you may have Y, you may have Z, and you may have, you may have A, B, comma C, and it keeps on going on. But all these data, they will be doing the same thing. They will be yesterday we were when we ran the program, we had a the threaded program where we are getting the salary of each employee, right? So we had a list of employees and we were getting the salary. Whoever has a salary greater than let's say 10,000 rupees or something, so the function is the same, but the data is their data is huge, and that's where the instructions is the same, but the data is different. So how do we so this kind of problem we mentioned that this is a we have to decompose the data itself, not the instructions. So this kind of problem statements is called domain domain decomposition problem, right? So I'm just going to take the space a little bit down. And domain decomposition problems are of which type? They are embarrassingly parallel problems. So the first, so this type of problem is, and so some computer issues there. So this type of problems where so let me save this diagram first. So we said this type of problem is a domain decomposition problem where the entire data is your domain set. It may be your data, your scientific data, your engineering data. So usually in scientific and engineering applications, we operate on lot of data. So the and then we have to perform some operations on that, and that the way to do it is you divide it into data set. So X and Y may be part of one data set which will be given to one core. Then Z and A will be assigned to the second core, and then B and C will be assigned to the third core. And we in Java, we yesterday when we ran the demo, we saw a very basically there were two for loops. One for loop was very simple, like it was just running I is equal to 0 and I less than 10,000 employees. And somewhere it said so you have to study the program for that. It was a simple sequential access over here. It was this kind of program. So then we calculated the time taken for the sequential processing. Inside this get salary function, we were also printing it to the screen, and we realized like when we print it to the screen, it is an input output operation. So so your screen is an output, and your program running on the processor is is doing that input output operation. So that operation itself took 12,000 milliseconds using the sequential approach. But the moment we remove that you know, we had a statement inside that get salary, right? We had a statement called system dot out dot println. This statement itself took you know, we were doing this println for how many employees? We were doing it for 10,000 employees. Every time this loop was running through, we are doing a system dot out, and it took around 12 seconds to run, which was like 12,000. This program using sequential approach took 12,000 milliseconds. And the moment you commented this code, you know, you kind of went like, and then we what we did, we commented this part of the code. And the moment you commented this part of the code, the instruction get salary was as simple as reading the data. It is, there's no input, there's no output, it's just like fetching the data, and that took only 24 milliseconds just using the sequential approach. And then you know, then we ran the same for loop, but this time what we did, we used a kind of a magic code inside. So you have to study this code, you know, what, how it was actually written. And we did something similar, but we applied a magic code, something which is in Java, which is called dot, so something like, you can say we did data dot parallel stream. So it is a very specific programming syntax of Java salary. We had something like this. You have to find the exact syntax, but how it was done. And then what we did, we took this statement and we applied it on this for loop. This is what we did yesterday. So how was parallelism achieved through this? Now what Java was doing, because you modified the statement into a simple data set into a parallel stream, internally it kind of did what would an SIMD would do. It took your entire data set 0 to 1000, your entire data set, and broke it down into a different data set, you know. So in this case the data set would be one would have 0, other one would have 1, third, second would have 3rd, then, so there were 10,000 data sets, each containing one data element. And what operation did we do on each of these data elements? Every operation ran a function parallelly, get salary. So this is what Java did magically for you. You didn't have to, you know, write any complex code. Internally all that distribution of task, you know, to the multiple threads or to the multiple cores, so, you know, whatever is available, Java will know internally that you have a multi-core system, or you have a multi-thread, you know, you can do multi-threading. Definitely at a high level, multi-threading is the first step anyone, any program would do, right? So this fellow would run get salary, and the same time all the programs would be doing the same thing, but they are doing in parallel. It doesn't matter now, and it is an embarrassingly parallel problem, because the same instruction is repeatedly carried out. Everyone is doing get salary, and it doesn't matter in which order, you know, if you have your data set in 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 order, it doesn't matter if number 1 gets executed first or number 10,000 gets executed first. So this kind of problem, you know, make it easier for your Java program to stream all your data set into parallel. So these are basically streams, right? One stream, two streams, three streams, and they're all running parallelly. And this is what this one simple line of code diagram. I don't have the control, my mouse is, you know, responding slowly as fast as I'm moving. Okay, so this entire set of code, so let me just color it, is running as a parallel stream. So this is one way of doing parallel programming, and this is one part of your demo also. Right, and so then we went, so let me, can I do it on the same screen? Hold on. So let me delete some part of this now, okay, because I need the space. So another way of parallelism, so this kind of your domain decomposition problem, where you divide your entire data into subsets of data, is also called data parallelism. Okay, so that term is, so whenever you are looking at parallelism, you have to determine, okay, what type of parallelism are we looking at? Are we looking at data parallelism? Are we looking at the master slave model parallelism? Which is, are we looking at a multi-core processor level parallelism? Which level of parallelism is how we are looking at? Are we looking at multi-threading? Are we looking at the hardware level, or are we looking at the software level? At every level, everybody is like, your program may be doing multi-threading, so it is doing multi-threading, plus it may be doing data parallelism also. In this case, this is not, we are not writing a multi-threaded program, but we are definitely internally using Java's mechanisms of using multi-threading pool. We spoke about a thread pool, right? So what Java does is, it has its own, the runtime has its own set of thread pools ready to be executed. If anybody wants that thread, it will give it to the program. So in this case, we wanted 10,000 threads to be run, but in the thread pool, there may be only 1,000 threads. So Java will give those 1,000 threads to you if your program is of the highest priority that is currently been executed. And every time you are running through the loop, the 1,000 thread pools, the 1,000 threads in the thread pool will execute 1,000 instructions in the single go. And if you have 4 cores running, in my case, there are 8 cores, right? Because my one core is also hyper-threaded. So I've got 8 cores. So at a time, I'm able to run 8 instructions at a time, you know, so that once that process of 1,000 instructions is done, then you remove it from the pool and you take the another 1,000. So in 10 loops, so instead of going 10,000 times, now Java will move, only 10 times. It will take 1,000 at a time. So there will be only 10 loops and it will be parallel streamed, and that 1,000 also will, you divide it into 8 processors, right? 8 cores are there, then that means only 8 you can pick up and assign it to the processor. So even if it is multi-threaded, if you have 1,000 threads but 4 cores, you can execute as much as the cores, right? So that's where we spoke about multi-threading. Usually, we have multi-threading is done at the application level, right? But if your processor itself is not supporting multiple execution of instructions, then your multi-threading application won't be that fast, right? So for a good parallel application, you require multiple cores at the hardware level, where you can run multiple instructions on the hardware. But also you require a multi-threading. You, at every level, parallelism has to be achieved. And wherever data parallelism can be achieved, you should use data parallelism. So this is what we said yesterday. This is what is called concurrent computing. Okay. So far, whatever computing we have been talking about, it is at the level of single program. When we say single program, we are trying to say it is a single process, because every program, is not single program also, but you can have single applications and multiple programs also, right? So you can have like two Java programs in a single application, but they are running as a part of a single application program. But we are talking about single application which translates to single process and which translates to single thread. And this single thread is your master thread, which can spawn multiple threads. When we say spawning a thread, we are also saying we are creating a child thread. This is also called fork over here. So we spawn a child thread. So you can have multiple threads within the same process. So if it is part of the same process, that means memory can be shared in the single process. Otherwise, if there is another application running on your same box, that is a different process. The data of one process cannot be accessed by the data of the second process. But all the child threads may have access to the, they share a common memory as well as they share a local memory. So each thread will not only have its local private memory, but it will also have a shared memory with the parent process. So this was all about concurrent computing. Now now I can probably remove this diagram. So now we are kind of moving into the second level. Now we are not talking only about one application, we are talking about many applications, right? So you can assume that each application is a concurrent computing parallel application. You can assume that one application has already implemented a parallel program inside that, and it is using the maximum power of the cores of the processor of that machine. So far we have been talking about application, threads, processor all on a single machine, but here we are talking about many applications and many computers. We are not only looking at parallelism at a single machine level, that is assumed so far, but at the task computing level we are looking at many applications and we are looking at many computers. So this kind of environment, okay, hold on, charging, this kind of environment where you have multiple computers, they have to be connected, they have to be in some way connected to each other, right? Either in the local area network, either over the internet, you know, somewhere you have to make sure they are in the network of computers. So this kind of when you run take many applications, you know, that is part of your single problem statement, but it comes under distributed computing, right? So your distributed computing is also a form of parallelism, right? So where you have many computers and those computers have a processor of their own. So when you are taking one application and then in that, if you have two applications and then one application you're giving to computer one and the second application you're giving to computer two, and both the and each of these application itself is a parallel program, you know, so you are kind of able to solve bigger problems because you are not only using the multi-core, you're not only using the multi-thread, but you're also using multiple computers, or you can say a processing node. Your computer is nothing but a computing node. You can say it is a node. Okay, so when we say node, machine, it all reflects the same thing. And this is where task computing is all about. So your task computing is a kind of a bigger level problem statement. You know, your problem statements are now really so this is where task computing comes in. Task computing is a mixture or is a kind of a distributed computing problem. Okay. So let us save this and move on to the new diagram. Okay, So when we say task computing, we already know what computing means, right? Computing means you have to run some set of instructions or. To run some set of instruction to then maybe a multi-threaded program, you know, the computation is you know, we already to do some calculations, right? But when we what is a task, then the question is that, right? Your task, you can say, there is like a program. Okay, one task, we're talking about one task. It is a program or a application, or you can say it is a process also. But usually when we talk about task, we are mostly referring to application level, okay? So one application. So this application may have multiple programs in that, and that each program in that application may be multi-threaded, and each thread may be assigned, will be running a parallel stream, which is running on parallel processors. So at every level, the processor is happening. But when we talk about task computing, we are mostly talking about application level task. Okay, so this is a, to run this application is a task. Now, any application will, you know, how does your any application work? There is some input data and there is some output data. So an application is meaningless if it doesn't do something, right? So if you're doing a sine function, then the input data is x, and so here you get x, and here you get a function of x, right? Fx. So I hope this is also mathematics. So most of the so you have to realize one of the things, like, you know, this in your real world, when you apply, let's say for you look out for jobs, you know, they are not talking about all this. Because it doesn't come under, most of the jobs that is seen in the market is business application type of problems. You know, most of the businesses, they put an advertisement. So where are these problem statements usually been used at a, such a high level where you have to coordinate is usually in scientific and engineering application. So if you go to, if you look at any scientist or, you know, who is, or any engineering, you know, engineer, somebody who's solving the real engineering problem, right? They will most likely, you know, they are, they will have a huge data set, they'll have a lot of calculations to be done. And this is a niche area, you can say, a parallel programmer, you know, where everybody is not into this programming, but it is something where you can even not go into this niche area. But definitely they don't, you have to approach them directly to the, you know, to be part of the experiments and, you know, be part of their job. So this kind of job is also very easy, but you have to deal with the scientific domain, the engineering domain. You have to understand what the problem statements are, and you have to come, you are a parallel programmer, then you have to come up with a parallel programming plan. So anytime parallel programmer, the first task, how do you solve a, so first you take a solve a problem, like a modeling of a, you know, a scientific data. So so somewhere so when you have to so for example, you know, what was the climate, how did the climate change in the last 100 years? So for last 100 years means every day you will have to run one program for that, some data will be given to that, and some calculation will come out of that. That will become your one program, and that has to be done for each and every day, right? For 100 years means 365 into 100 is equal to, you have to repeat this process for 365 into 100 times, which is like, you know, quite a bit, right? So for each day, the processing of data will be huge when you're looking at climate change data. Like, there are a lot of factors, you're looking into the climate change. You know, you're looking at the sky, you're looking at the water, you're looking at the entire atmosphere. So there are a lot of calculations done parallelly, just at one application level. So this kind of problem statements cannot be done very fast by a single computer or by a single processor. You know, you have to have a parallel programming plan. So that is the time, the least you can do is definitely every program that you write, you make sure it is parallel, it is tuned for parallel execution. And the second level of parallelism, definitely you move at task computing. So decomposition is your main planning statement, right? How do you decompose a problem and divide it into multiple threads, multiple data sets, or multiple tasks? So this entire thing is kind of one task, right? So here you get an input data, it goes inside, and you get output data. But remember, we have to run this application. If you're running this one application for over to simulate something for 100 years, then you're looking for 365 days into year into 100 days. So every time you run one simulation program, so one simulation program means you have this many repetitions. So you need kind of how many tasks you will require? 3, 5, 6. So you're not looking only at one application, right? In one application, this may be looking at the atmosphere, for example, right? Something like the earth, you can say the beyond the atmosphere data, you know, the whatever the universal data. I'm not so good at all this, but you have to understand scientific problem statements is not going to be just one problem within the bigger problem statement. Just that one problem will have multiple problems, multiple factors. A rocket flying to a Mars is not doing one thing, no, it is doing 100 things at one time. One application is doing 100 things. So your one application is doing 100 tasks, and that one application has to be repeated every time. So do you understand the multiplication factor over here? So this can become your so this itself can be your one problem statement, right? Which you need to solve it. And this problem statement contains of how many you can decompose this into two tasks. And you need to each task, so this is task number one, and this is task number two. So as I said, the application in itself will have multiple programs, and the application in itself will be doing parallelism on its own. But here we are talking about task level parallelism. So you have task one, task two, which is part of the same problem statement, and then each task you need to repeat it 3, 5, 6 into 100 times, and every time you finish solving one problem, you need to collect the data from atmospheric data and the universal data and come up with your result, right? So here you come up with a result. So this is mostly any parallel programming problem statements will be of this kind, where on one end you take a problem statement and you run a mapping function. This is also inside, this is your part of your MapReduce platform, where you take a map something and you divide it into multiple problems, and you take each problem and similar problems, and like atmospheric, you have to solve 3, 5, 6 into 100 times, right? So again, it is a data parallelism problem. So you kind of map it as per your plan, and in the end make sure the right set of data is coming together, and this is called the reduction function, right? So your reduction function is nothing but your summing up all your data coming from different data sets, and all the related data is bringing together, and ultimately you have to come with a result, and you have to tell in the end what is the effect of climate, right? So climate change results. So here your mapping function will come, your atmosphere data will come in this place over here, and your universal, how it is interacting with your atmosphere, that data, both the data sets will come inside over here. It will run through your mapping function, and the mapping function, so you will have an atmospheric function, you will have one universal function. So a parallel Programmer, the first task will be when you look at the problem statement, a scientist comes to you, an engineer comes to you and say, okay, this is a problem, how do we solve it on the computer? The first thing you need to do is how to decompose it. How can you make it independent of each other? How do you make sure there's no communication between the tasks? Now, in this case, task one and task two may be tightly bound, okay? So at some point, you cannot have total non-communication at all ends, but if you have multiple data points, like in this case, we are calculating for 365 days, it is actually. So 365 days into 100 for 100 years, then you have this many data points. So the data points within the single task is embarrassingly parallel problem. But the task one and task two are not embarrassingly parallel problem. These are part of your functional decomposition problem. So you cannot, your functional decomposition problem are somewhere related either in the beginning or in the end or while it is running, right? So in this case, let us assume both the task is, it can be independently executed. But even if it can be independently executed, at the end, you need to run your reduction function, right? This function is dependent. So on your different task number one and task number two. So right, so this is where this is what task computing is about. It is a higher level of computing, which is mostly we need to solve it. How we need to solve it? Using distributed computing solution. So your concurrent computing was solved using parallel, running multi-threading and multi-processors. But in task computing, you're looking at distributed computing. So that is also one form of parallel computing. So now let us just understand distributed computing. So let us remove this. So earlier we had done an assignment on your service oriented computing, right? So that was one way of solving the problem using distributed computing. So what did we do over there? We had a client browser who is trying to solve a problem, and then we had a microservice architecture. We had service one running over here, right? Customer, and then we had service two, where we had some account task been done, and we had service three, where we were doing some transaction task. So this is a example of though my application was running on the same computer, I could have made sure that this services are running anywhere in the world, because it is using HTTP protocol and I can write distributed application in this fashion. So this is one way of distributed computing, right? We are distributing your computations. And but when we are looking at a bigger problem statement, something like we are calculating the data for 100 years or 10 years, how do we will this model be enough? So in this case, so let us now change the problem statement. So let us assume let me just remove this. So we are still, let's say we are still doing service oriented computing. We want to use service oriented computing because that is one of the easiest way to connect computers across the world, right? So here you have a problem statement where you need to run a simulation model to examine climate change over the period of 100 years. So this is your problem statement. Now you can run it from your browser, or so you can have a client browser, you know, which kinds of initiates your that problem statement, and then or you're going to have a Java program also running. The client program can be anything. It can be your Python program. It can be anything, right? So it doesn't matter. But ultimately, how you have divided this decomposes problem, so you will have a atmosphere, you know, service, okay, and then you will have a something non, you know, something that interacts with your atmosphere. Universe service. So you're going to give this you have two services where each service is supposed to calculate 100 years data, right? So 100 years data means 365 repetitive task. Here you have 36,500 repetitive tasks to calculate atmospheric data, and here you have another 36,500 repetitive tasks. So this task is what? An embarrassingly parallel problem. Now when you so here you have this task, and your single computer may not be enough, right? And in that case you can probably use you can use a cluster. So cluster 1, and this can be your cluster 2. So what is a cluster? A cluster is basically a set of similar computers. Set of similar computers. When you say similar computers, means similar set of softwares and hardware. They all have the same power, so it doesn't matter which machine within the cluster you're giving the task. They all have the, if one is a quad core, then other one is also a quad core, mostly performing the same task. Right? And so here you have another set of machines. So cluster is usually, you will, tied into a single geographical area. So you will not find a cluster of computer which is like one is in America and another is in India. Either you're looking at the India cluster of computers, or either maybe you're looking at, so this is a cluster of, let's say, four computers. This is not processors, okay? Each computer has its own processor. It can be a quad core also. So we are, so I hope you can imagine that we are moving at a very little higher level, beyond the machine, at the machine level, and we are looking at network of computers. So cluster is usually, you know, your kind of a, let's say your lab, right? Your lab, you can make it a cluster of computer because it is all in the same place, and you can, it is all having the same configuration. So that is what the cluster is. So this cluster is in the, so just like we have this cluster over here, I can have another cluster over here. So I have a cluster of 8 computers, which means I can definitely run 8 tasks at a time, right? But each computer has got 4 cores, right? So that means each core can run 4 tasks, which means how many in single clock cycle I can run 32 repetitions, right? Per clock cycle. And in 1 second, if I have 10,000 clock cycles, means now in this case how many repetitions I will need, you know, in case if I have 36,500 task, you know. So if I am using SIMT model, like your GPU, right, where you can run so many threads in a single go. So this is like SIMD plus multi-threading. A CUDA core, if you're running this on a GPU, then you are looking at running more instructions and very fast, because GPU has its own memory, it has its own clock cycle, and it has its own cache. A GPU is like an independent processing unit. It does not really depend on the CPU. If you have a communication, your CPU is like your master processor and your GPU is like your slave processor, but that slave is very powerful enough to do all his operations on his own. It doesn't require to go to the RAM, it doesn't require to talk to CPU, it doesn't want to and the GPU also has a direct wire going to your screen, so it doesn't have to talk to CPU every time it has to display something on the screen. Because it has a direct hardware connection to the screen, it can take your video processing data and immediately show it on the screen, and that is how, why the games are working faster with GPU. But this kind of problem statements, you can break it down and give it to your GPU also. So this is where your GPU will come into use. So if you have a parallel programming problem statement, then definitely you have to think about using GPU. So if 32, one core can run 32 threads, then we, one core can manage 32 threads, which is your GPU, if you're using your GPU, then you are still, now you're able to do a lot more, right? So you're looking at approximately 13 to 30, which is like 900 threads, so which means 900 instructions are running in one clock cycle. And if you divide 36500 divided by 900, it is almost like dividing by 1000. So in 36 clock cycles itself, you can get your output. Okay. So somebody has to take this atmospheric service request. Somebody has to take this request from the client. And then there has to be a kind of a, let's say, a middleware somewhere in between. Maybe you're not going directly to your cluster. Every time you have to talk, you're talking to the middleware instead. Now middleware can be one, two, that depends on your design, right? So we remove this connection from here now. And remember, this middleware can be not necessarily in the same location. Okay, all these programs, they may be interacting using whatever ways across the world or across the state, we do not know. And there can be multiple middlewares also, right? What is the job of a middleware then? Job of the middleware is not only to schedule the task, but also to assign it, and if necessary, it can. So this is like your coordinator program, right? Which will schedule whatever task it is receiving, which can load the software libraries, which can start a runtime environment. So it is not only taking the task and assigning it to a cluster. Somebody, that cluster is nothing but a piece of hardware, right? Ultimately. So somebody has to make sure Java, if you're running a Java program, somebody has to install Java over here on this computer. So who's going to do that? So a middleware is the software which is going to take care, it is going to see, this is a Java based request, so I need this is a version of Java that needs to be installed on this computer. If it is a cluster, then you have to make sure that Java program is Java. When you say Java program, we're not talking about this Java program, but we're talking about the JDK, right? We have to install Java. So which is your Java runtime environment. That runtime environment, installing Java itself is a one step of the process. So that has to be done on all the computers of the cluster. Once it is installed, then only the task can be taken and executed on this computer. And whatever results are fetched, that has to be given back, with the help of a middleware. Middleware will know when the task has started, task has ended, you know. So the performance of a task computing is done by, you know, so by knowing how many jobs are completed or how many tasks is completed. So usually the measurement is in terms of months. So how many tasks, because some of these simulation programs, they don't run for within one day. The entire simulation does not get away. It may be a very big simulation of 100 years if you're calculating, or maybe 1000 year simulation program you're running, then it may take the full month for you to run that one problem statement. So you are not looking at simple problem statement which just runs in one time and it gets over. No, you're looking at a lot of tasks to be done, and you're looking at a very big problem statement which requires a very powerful computing power, but also something that does not fail. If one task in the entire problem statement fails, then you have to make sure that things are coordinated properly. So ultimately it is the problem of how you're decomposing it, how you're coordinating it, how you're scheduling it, and how you're managing it, right? And if one job fails, then you may have to rerun the job. So you may use your own type of distributed computing models for that. But how is the performance in task computing done, measured? It is measured in terms of how many tasks and jobs can be completed in a month. I may have a 10,000 tasks, I may have a 1,000 tasks. So this is how task computing is measured. If you are going at the processor level, CPU level, right, how are we calculating, how it is measured, the performance is measured in MIPS, right? How many instructions it can, million instructions per second it can execute. So each component, whether it is a processor, whether it is a task, you know, the kind of problem statement each one is trying to solve is little different. The GPU, how are we measuring the performance? It is in terms of floating points. Right, so in task computing also we have three types, HPC, HPC and MTC. HTC is high throughput computing, right? So, and HPC is high performance computing, and this is multi task computing. So we'll have a look at this. But I hope you all have understood what is a task. And what kind of problem statements are we looking at? So cluster is using cluster technology is one of the ways of solving your distributed computing problems. The other options are your grid, right? Your grid is nothing. Your grid may be operating on different, within a cluster, all the computers are same, but a grid is like a mixture of anything and everything. So a grid may be connected to cluster type 1. It may be connected to a simple commodity machine over here. So your commodity machine is like your laptop, okay? So your laptop is like your commodity machine which can do something for you. And you may have a cloud service over here. So each of these connections, it is not the same type of computer, right? It is a different type of computer. So a grid is basically is a technology where you can mix and match anything and create a distributed computing solution. So not all type of it's not necessary that all type of task you have to run it on clusters only. Sometimes you will require a cluster. Sometimes a commodity machine may be good enough. Sometimes you may have to use a cloud service, because cloud is a is almost like a data center is available to you, right? You can have any number of computers, any number of programs that can be run. A single commodity machine, you have a quad core, then you know, you may be able to run, you know, like seven, maybe three or four applications at a time. And if you have an office of, you know, 1,000 commodity machines in the office, in the night time, usually these commodity machines will be off, right? So you can use your grid technology, your cluster technology to use all these machines in the night time when no one is working on the machines. You can mix and match your, you can even think at the mobile levels, I think, you know, where you are creating a network of your Wi-Fi network of your mobile phones, and then you're using the processing power of the mobile itself, you know, to solve a particular problem. So ultimately everything is a kind of a processor, right? It's a processor or a group of processor. It's a network of processor. So you can mix and match. So grid is a kind of a mix of heterogeneous set of computers and software, as you can see. It is not even the same software. And a cluster is basically opposite of grid. It is a homogeneous set of computers and softwares. So cluster is mainly used to solve one type of problem statements, or so you can have two different types of problem statement, but both the problem statements, they need similar type of computers and similar type of softwares. In a grid, you may have one cluster running your Java runtime, right? And you may have another cluster over here, which may be running Hadoop kind of architectures, you know, over here. Yeah, Hadoop is like your MapReduce platform, right? Where you have a master computer and where you have your slave computer. Your slave computers can be a cluster. So your slaves can be your cluster set. So because Hadoop uses multiple machines, you know, the cost to, that's why it is expensive on cloud service. So I mentioned that if you run a Elastic MapReduce, so if you use Elastic MapReduce on AWS, they have the problem, depending on how big the problem statement, they're going to charge for you, because they're creating that many machines on the fly. So I was charged like ₹6 for doing that experiment, which I've given in the demo. But definitely now you know why they are charging you that, because they are creating as many machines as you need. You can control the number of machines that are created by configuring your Hadoop or whatever EMR, you know, the way you want it. But if you don't want to use EMR AWS service, then try to use Hadoop on your local box. You can simulate a MapReduce platform on the single machine also. Ultimately, these are like different programs communicating with each other, right? There's a master program and there's a slave program. The only difference is all the slaves will be running on the same computer. Okay. So, let's run through this slide to see if we have to add anything. So task computing is a wide area of distributed. That word distributed is very important, right? It is not only parallel, but it is also distributed. When you say distributed, it is distributed among computers. So it is a distributed system programming. We are not talking about business applications. We are talking about mostly about system level programming, where for us the front end does not matter. It's the back end processing, which becomes the main challenge. So it encompasses several different models of architecting distributed application, which eventually are based on the fundamental abstraction, the task. So what is a unit of work for task computing? The unit of work is task. This task may be consisting of multiple application, an atmospheric application, a universe application. You know, that each application can have multiple program. One will be a set of Java program, one will be a set of Python program. But for us at a task computing level, a task is a unit of work, not a program, not an application, not a thread. That is a different level of computation. A task generally represents a program which might require input files and produce output files. So we have already spoken about this. And here I am distinguishing between concurrent computing and task computing. A thread is just a set of single flow of execution, which is like a function, right? A function which is consisting a set of statements, which is nothing but a set of machine instructions. A single thread is usually given to one core, or either it is a physical core or either it is a logical core. And then what is a process? A process is basically a collection of many threads, right? You can spawn many threads within a single process. So that is what concurrent computing is all about. And when you come to task computing, we are talking about a goal. You know, this is my goal. What is my goal? I want to simulate a climate change that happened over the period of last 100 years, or how it will happen in the next 100 years. I can simulate it. So that is a goal which can contain one or more programs or applications. So definitely you're looking at a network of computers. Here you're looking at a network of processors or cores, and here you're looking at one core. So this statement says organizing an application in terms of task is the most intuitive and common practice for developing parallel and distributed computing. So now you understand what is the difference between parallel and distributed computing. Parallel is mostly we are talking about on the same computer, multi-processors and multi-threading. But when the moment you say distributed, you are also saying that it is on not only on one machine, but it is on multiple machines. In practice, a task is represented as a distinct unit of code or a program that can be separated and executed in a remote runtime environment. Right? So what is a runtime environment? Runtime environment is like your Java runtime environment. Before you can run your Java program, you need to install the Java runtime environment. Whatever program, whatever language you're using to run, you require that platform. So you're mostly talking about the platform that is provided to run that program. And that runtime environment also has to be installed before you actually run the program. So that has to be an automatic process mostly. You cannot go manually there and install Java and then you run the Java program. That is like, you know, we manual intervention should never be there in a task computing problem or a parallel computing problem. It should all be automated. A multi-threaded programming is mainly concerned with programming providing a support for parallelism within a single machine. A task computing provides distribution by harnessing the compute power of several computing nodes. So when you say computing nodes, we are talking about several machines. A concurrent computing is performing parallelism on a single machine. A task computing is performing parallelism on many machines. So historically, what is the infrastructure that you are going to use to do task computing? You may use a cluster, or you may use a grid, you may use a cloud, you may use a supercomputer. So your supercomputer can be a modern time mainframe, which has a lot more processors and a lot more memory, and it is tuned for parallel processing. So this is when you're deciding your task computing problem. There is going to be a node which is going to submit the task, right? Like your client browser, your client application, which is going to give it to the which is going to say this is a task which I have. And ultimately you can see over here the different things that is done by different nodes. So the local node will submit the task, provide input files and receive output files. And the task itself is a program that needs to be executed. What is an access node? Access node accepts the task request, schedules the task, submits it to the middleware to manage it and receives task status, receiving output files. And middleware is coordinating the resources used to execute it. So computing nodes contains a runtime environment like Java, and remote environment may represent a third party cloud or a third party task executor. So when I said middleware is scheduling, it is actually the access nodes which are receiving the task. This fellow is taking all the tasks. You may have not one node but many nodes, which is kind of the main duty of the access nodes will be to just to make sure it is scheduled properly and given to the correct middlewares. You may have a set of different middlewares inside your system across the world. And this middleware will make sure, you know, this middleware, maybe let's say you are you have tuned it to run Java applications and clusters. So one middleware may be a champion of running Java program and maybe a champion of running clusters. The other middleware may be a champion of running MapReduce kind of problem statements in a MapReduce platforms. So middlewares may also make sure that they install the necessary, they create the necessary runtime environments, whether it is a database that is required, whether that is a configuration required, everything is automated by the middleware. And computing node ultimately is the machine which is going to run that function which you have given as part of your task. It is actually the computing node is ultimately the executioner of the task. Whatever results the compute node gives, it has to give back to the middleware, and the middleware has to give back to the access nodes, and the access nodes has to give back to the local node. A remote environment is something which you don't have control over, but somebody else is providing you that environment. So your cloud is a very good example where you're going to a cloud and performing some calculations and coming back. So ultimately, your middleware can talk to your remote environment also. So how can you submit a task? An API, maybe web interface, like a web service you can use. You can use a REST service. You can use a programming language interface. So you can use all these service-oriented computing architectures to submit the request. So we already spoke about the middleware. And this is all the definition. A task is a general abstraction that identifies a program, combination of programs that constitute computing unit of a distributed application with a tangible output. A task may also need specific software appliances on the remote execution nodes. So these are your computing nodes, right? This may be cloud also. If you're going on the cloud and the cloud itself doesn't have the software, then your middleware has to make sure those softwares are available on the cloud. You have to upload that software and configure it as necessary. And then it will be ready to execute the task. So sometimes there may be a manual operation, but you should reduce the manual operation as much as possible. So that is what the first took so much time. So I think we have kind of briefed today on the definition of task and how task is distributed computing is managed, and so we'll kind of wrap it today, I feel, over here. And we have two more presentations in this area.